Now, I don't know if there are any closet country music fans out there. I suspect Pat is. I had my eye on Pat. Can I get a yee-haw? Can I get a yee-haw? Yeah, great. Instead of an amen, it's a yee-haw this morning. When it comes to this question of unanswered prayer, you know, Garth Brooks released a song called Unanswered Prayers, looking at this very topic. And I thought it'd be a great way for us to just start. The song goes like this, and do sing it, Pat, if you feel you want to join in. Just the other night at a hometown football game, my wife and I ran into my old high school flame. And as I introduced them, the past came back to me, and I couldn't help but think of the way things used to be. She was the one that I wanted for all times, and each night I'd spend praying that God would make her mine. And if he'd only grant me this wish I wished back then, I'd never ask for anything again. Sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Remember when you're talking to the man upstairs, that just because he doesn't answer doesn't mean he don't care. Some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. She wasn't quite the angel that I remembered in my dreams, and I could tell that time had changed me. In her eyes too, it seemed. We tried to talk about the old days. There wasn't much we could recall. I guess the Lord knows what he's doing after all. And as she walked away, and I looked at my wife, and then and there I thanked the good Lord for the gifts in my life. Sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Remember when you're talking to the man upstairs, that just because he may not answer doesn't mean he don't care. Some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. Yeehaw! Yeah! I should have sung it. I didn't. I, unlike Pat, am not a closet country music fan, so unfortunately I didn't know the melody. He's not closet. So Garth Brooks finds in his unanswered prayer God's blessing, and maybe you too can think of unanswered prayers that have actually turned out to be a blessing in your life. I know I have. But for many people, the question of unanswered prayer is anything but a blessing. For some people, unanswered prayer has meant that they have given up on trying to keep company with God. In fact, I have met people in this church who, for them, this is their experience. To them, though they believe in God's existence, he appears as someone who is generally distant and disinterested in them, simply because their experience of prayer has been that it has felt God hasn't answered them. And I suspect that they're not alone. You know, from time to time, we all may wonder if our prayers are being heard, let alone answered. Well, one of the comforting things that we find in Scripture is that the experience of unanswered prayer is not a foreign experience to the people of God. And as we've been studying the Psalms, we have seen times when God's people lament his seeming unresponsiveness to their requests. We think too in the New Testament of Paul, who asked three times for the thorn in his flesh to be removed, this thing that was causing suffering for him, for God to come and remove it, and yet it wasn't. And even Jesus himself had prayer go unanswered in the Garden of Gethsemane when he asked that God might remove the cup of wrath from him. It's not an uncommon experience for God's people. And yet, Jesus' teaching on prayer encourages us to ask and make requests to God. We are encouraged to be annoyingly persistent and audacious in prayer, to pray believing that it will be answered, and we are told that our Heavenly Father loves to give us good gifts. And so if we're encouraged to pray in this way, then why still do we experience unanswered prayer? Well, perhaps the most obvious assumption that's embedded in this question is that the only answer that God should give us is always yes. But if God is God, then surely he is free to answer our prayers with different kinds of responses. And if that's so, then it could be the case that God is answering our prayers, but just not in the way that we hoped for, expected, or desired. Sometimes God's answer to our prayer will be a no. But this doesn't mean that God doesn't love us. In fact, it's an indication of his immense commitment to us. George MacDonald once wrote that a God that should fail to hear, receive, attend to one single prayer, the feeblest or worst, I cannot believe in. But a God that would grant every request of every man or every company of men would be an evil God. That is no God, but a demon. A God that grants every single request is not a God, but a demon. What is MacDonald getting at here? Well, I think he's getting at something like this, that we in our finite and limited understanding have the propensity to ask for things that are not actually good for us. And indeed, if we were to have those things, they would only serve to spoil us and indeed wreak havoc upon this earth. But God, like any good father, will say no to his children, not because he wants them to miss out on life, but precisely because he wants them to experience the fullness of life. And as a loving father, he knows that to always indulge his children's every desire will only serve to diminish their life in the long run. As the one who made us and knows us, he is far better positioned than we are to know what that fullness of life really looks like. So sometimes God's answer will be, no, this is not the right thing for you. And hopefully there'll come a time in retrospect when, like Garth Brooks, we will be able to thank him for it. At other times, though, it will be a matter of God's timing. Sometimes God's answer will not be no, but rather slow. And in fact, by causing us to wait, God is doing something far greater in answer to our prayers. You know, in John 11, there's a wonderful example of this. In John 11, we read the account of Mary, Martha, and their brother Lazarus. Lazarus, as you all will be aware, is very sick, and the two sisters send word to Jesus to tell him that the one that he loves is unwell. Now, the subtext of this is basically that the sisters are asking Jesus, praying to him, come quickly, and make Lazarus better. But you know what we read upon hearing about Lazarus' sickness? When Jesus hears about it, he intentionally delays his journey by 2 days. In other words, he makes the sisters wait. And in their waiting, Lazarus dies. And so by the time Jesus makes it to them, Lazarus is well and truly in the grave. But it's precisely because of this that Mary has one of the most significant revelations about who Jesus is and what he is capable of. She experiences Jesus not only as a healer, but as the one who can overturn death itself. She comes to a deeper revelation of Jesus' true identity than she would have otherwise experienced. It was a revelation that was not only to be a gift for her and for Mary and for Lazarus, but also for generations to come. She and Mary become a part of God's greater purposes in writing history. Sometimes God and his timing wants to answer our prayers in an even greater way. My mom experienced this very thing. You know, she was brought up in a non-Christian home and came to faith in her teenage years. And her upbringing wasn't an easy one. Her dad was an alcoholic, my poppy, who eventually left home, leaving my grandmother as a single parent to fend for the family. Now, my mum had two siblings, an older brother and a younger sister. But tragically, my mum lost her sister, who she was very close to, in a car accident on Christmas Eve. And on Christmas Day, my aunt and her unborn child passed away. My auntie was pregnant at the time. I was about 4 years old. Now, the death of my auntie had a really big impact on my mum. I remember, even as a four-year-old girl, watching my mum change and enter into a deep time of grief and sadness. Her sister's death left her alone and feeling lonely. What I need to mention also is that my mum's brother had followed in the footsteps of his father and had run away from home. He had left the country, basically, and had got involved in drugs and gangs, and over time had lost touch with the family. He'd become estranged. So my mum was well and truly the only one left in her family. And over the years, as I grew into adulthood, one of the things that my mum had expressed to me often was that she often thought about her brother and prayed for him. She wondered where he was, but also that she felt alone in the world. She felt a real sense of loss that she didn't know him and that she didn't really have any family. I need to also mention that I remember as a little girl watching my grandmother as well, who had a very simple faith, sit at the dinner table and pray for my uncle, pray that his life would be put right. Well, about 7 years ago, out of the blue, my mum received a phone call from her brother. And he called her up and he said, not only am I back in the country, but I'm here in your hometown. Can I come and see you? Now, my mum was a little bit suspicious. She kind of thought that he probably just wanted to come and see her to get some money from her because he had lived a fairly rough and ready lifestyle. But actually, over the course of a few months, my parents got to know him and they shared the gospel with him. And my uncle, whose name is Uncle Kerry, became a Christian. He gave his life to the Lord. And for 2 years, my mum and my Uncle Kerry spent most days catching up. My Uncle Kerry, he was a wonderful man. He would just turn up every day after work, and my mum and he would, I'm going to get emotional, would sit and have a cup of tea together and just enjoy the friendship that comes from being brother and sister, remembering the old days, remembering their mum, remembering their family. 2 years later, though, my Uncle Kerry was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, and not long after, he passed away. But you know, when I talked to my mum about that, she wasn't sad. She was filled with thanksgiving because God's timing was perfect. At just the right time, God brought my uncle home, not just physically home, but spiritually home. In answer to the prayers of my grandmother and then my mother, God did a greater work. My mum received the gift of knowing her brother, and my uncle received the gift of knowing his Savior at just the right time. Sometimes God's saying, not yet. He's encouraging us, keep praying, keep persisting in prayer. It's not a no. My answer is simply just slow. Slow. But the answer will come, and it's worth the wait. Sometimes God's answer to our prayer will be grow. It might be the case that we are expecting God to answer our prayers, when in actual fact, he's asking us to first of all clean up some things in our lives. It could be, for example, that we have unconfessed sin in our life that God wants us to deal with. You know, James 5, verse 16 says that the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. And yet, does anyone know what directly precedes that verse? Anyone? It says, confess your sins one to another. It seems as if the effectiveness of prayer is connected to our willingness to confess our wrongs. In other words, God is more inclined to hear the prayers of those who are willing to be honest about their brokenness. He wants us to deal with our hearts first, to bring our hearts before him and to make our hearts right before him. It could be the case that we are expecting God to answer our requests when in fact our relationships with others are not right and we need to do the work of cleaning up those relationships in our lives. Scripture tells us that our horizontal relationships will have an effect on our vertical relationship with God and will impact our prayer life. For example, Mark 11, if we have unforgiveness in our heart towards another, that will affect our relationship with God. Matthew 5, if we have knowingly hurt someone and have not sought reconciliation with them, that will have an effect on our relationship with God. if we are not experiencing God's voice or answers to our prayers, it could be because something is not right in our relationship with others. And God, in his love for us, wants us to go and restore those relationships. He wants us to restore our heart before him, before he can then answer our requests. God can't ignore those things. In his love for us, he cannot ignore them. He will first call us to put those things right before he responds to our requests. Sometimes his answer will be, grow. And then sometimes God says, go. Not because he is our heavenly butler who exists to meet all our demands, but because he is our heavenly Father who loves to give good gifts to his children. And a part of his delight is to offer us the gift of being co-partners with him in bringing about his purposes in this world. In John 14, Jesus says one of the most remarkable words to his disciples. He says, "Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to my Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it." Not only does prayer change us, but Jesus seems to be suggesting that God is moved into action by our prayers. It is his delight and for his glory to answer our prayers if those prayers are in line with his heart for us and for this world. In this way, God has given us incredible freedom, dignity, and responsibility of being co-partners with him, to the point that when we begin to pray, it unleashes God's purposes in this world. If I put it simply, when we pray, stuff really does happen. Prayer really does make a difference. It's not just some pious self-talk that is therapeutic for us. Prayer is more than that. God works in response to our requests. As Philip Yancey writes, by using prayer rather than other direct means, God chooses the most freedom-enhancing style of acting in the world. God waits to be asked, and in some inscrutable way, making God's activity on earth contingent upon us. God is just waiting to be asked. Sometimes he's just waiting for us to appeal to his mercy and his power and his grace and his love so that he can answer yes to the prayers that we have not yet spoken. Why doesn't God answer my prayers? Could it be the answer is that he does, but just not always in the way that we want? Sometimes God's answer will be no, because it's not good for us. Sometimes it will be slow, because it's not yet the right time. Sometimes it will be grow, because he wants us to mature. And sometimes it will be go, because he delights in giving us good gifts. But you know what? All the time, prayer is an invitation to know and to be known. We've been on holidays this past week in France. I know you're all jealous, soaking in the sun. And I've been thinking about prayer. I've been reflecting upon the similarities between the child-parent relationship and Jesus' teaching on prayer. You know, my little Joseph is now 2 years old, and every day what I've noticed is he's adding to his language. And boy, does he know how to ask for what he wants. There's one particular day that I will kid you not, it was like he was on repeat. And continuously, he was saying just these words, "Wheels on bus on TV, wheels on bus on TV, wheels on bus on TV." And it just got progressively worse and worse. And I think I counted about 20 times that he said this line. And you can imagine what he wanted. He wanted to watch his little nursery rhyme, "Wheels on the bus on the TV." He was incredibly persistent about this desire and insistent that I meet this desire for him. And you know, sometimes persistence pays off. And as a parent, I relent, partly just to shush the child, partly because of his age, because I know that he's not yet at an age that he's able to understand why this might not be good for him, and partly because there are simply other battles to be won on that day. And I think there's probably a lesson in there around persistence and the Father heart of God. There's certainly a lot in Scripture that talks about us persisting in prayer. But I was comparing how my 2-year-old asked for things to how Jonathan, my very precocious 7-year-old, asked for things. Jonathan, too, wanted to watch something on the TV. But he came to me and said, "Now, you are probably going to say no, but could Grace and I watch this on the TV?" Now, despite the fact that he was trying to use reverse psychology on me, what I found really interesting was that Jonathan, unlike Joseph, came asking, already knowing that there would probably be a tension between his desire and my desire for him. And yet, he still came and he still asked. And because he asked, I was able to say to him, "Mate, you are totally right. I am going to say no, but here's why." Now, here's the thing. Over time, Jonathan had learnt something through the dance of relating with me. By asking and receiving, he had learnt more of who I am and how my heart is inclined towards him. He had experienced more of the reasons as to why there are times that I will say no. That there are times that I will say, "Not yet, mate, you're going to have to wait." That there will be times that I will say, "First you need to do this, you need to go say sorry to your sister, you need to clean up the Lego." And that there will be wonderful times to both his delight and mine when I will surprise him and say, "Yes, why not? Let's do it." But you know, his understanding, that understanding had come only through him coming to me and asking me, by him experiencing me in the way that I responded to him throughout his different ages and stages of maturity. You know, the ultimate goal of prayer is not to get what we want when we want it. The ultimate goal of prayer is to know God and to experience being known by him. The greatest gift of prayer is that we get to be friends with God. Ultimately, I want to pray for what God wants. And if God doesn't want something for me, then I shouldn't want it either. Because as my Heavenly Father, who has loved me from the moment he made me, and who has given his precious Son for me, and who's granted me the gift of the Holy Spirit to be with me, I can trust that his purposes for me are good. What he wants for me is the best thing for me. Now, of course, we're going to only discover that by coming to him with all of ourselves, including all of our asks. We might be like Joseph, like a 2-year-old toddler, I know I am, where we're controlled by our own desires. But in the relating, God will shape our heart. He will show us who we are. He will show us what he can do for us and through us. And that will be our greatest delight, for that is what we were made for. We were made to know him and to be known by him. So what about you? Are you friends with God? Or are you looking to God to be your heavenly butler? Do you make time in your life for friendship with God? Do you share your heart with him? And does he share his heart with you? Or are you so focused on what you want from God that you're not even asking the question, what does he want most of all from you? I've been really captivated by this one verse. It's in Romans 8, verse 34, and it tells us that after Jesus died on the cross and rose again, he now sits at the right hand of God. And do you know what it says he's doing? He's interceding on our behalf. He's praying for us. He's praying for you. He's praying for me. He's praying for us as a church. Now, I don't know about you, but I want to know what he's praying. I want that to be my goal in prayer, is to line my prayers up with the one who made me, the one who died for me, the one who fought for me, and the one who continues to pray for me now. I want to pray in line with his heart for me. after you. So let's stand. We're just going to take some time in response now. I just invite you just to close your eyes. And I just wonder if something about this morning has just tugged on your own heart, resonated with you. Maybe you feel disconnected from God right now. Maybe you're not sure what he thinks of you. Maybe you do just come to him with a long list of requests, but you don't actually take time to hear. What does he want from you? What is his hopes for your life? I'm just going to take a moment. I'm going to invite the musicians to come forward. And I just want to encourage you just to reconnect with him. Reconnect with him. He's there. He's waiting. He's longing to connect with you. He's longing to speak to you. And so maybe you just want to just open up your hands before him, your palms before him, just as a gesture of saying, Lord, speak. Speak to me. What is your heart for me? Let's just take a few moments of stillness to do that. Just invite him.